I'm Norman. I do a show called The Gaming Historian on Retroware TV as well. Talks about the history of video games, important events, characters, whatnot. And, yeah.
I'm Sid Bolton. I'm Canada's top video game collector and the only Canadian on the panel, I might add. Also curator and founder of the Personal Computer Museum in Brantford, which is Canada's only interactive computer museum, so come and visit us.
My name's Pat Conkley. I'm a video game collector, and I do videos online, and I'm goofy.
You are not goofy, Pat.
Billy and I go to flea markets and, you know, wherever to find retro games with my life partner here, Jay. We are the Game Chasers.
What he said.
And Pedro, life partner, by the way.
Yeah, we're not like, all the way there.
Just part of the way there. What does that even mean?
Okay, so, I mean, we're going to be pretty, we have some topics here we're going to go over, but it'll be pretty freeform, I guess. We're booked for 2 hours, but I don't think you guys are going to be stuck in for 2 hours. But, we'll talk about lots of stuff, about collecting. So we have a topic here about tackling a large system by breaking up into subsections. I guess, Sid, if you want to start about what you mean by that in terms of collecting.
Well, one of the things that myself as a collector, if you've decided what you want to collect, that's great. If you're like me and you want to collect everything, that's a problem. And so what I found is, for example, if you take a system like a PlayStation and you want to try and collect, it can be pretty daunting. There's a lot of things to collect. So one of the ways I approach this problem is to try collecting sub-collections. So for example, with the original PlayStation, you can collect all the long box games. There's like over 100 games that are originally available in the long box format. Most of them are not, but it gives you something to try and feel like you've accomplished partway through a rather long journey. Really, really long journey if you're trying to get PlayStation 2. And so maybe what you might want to do is focus on either franchises or developers or genres. So maybe you really like fighting games, collect all the fighting games for that system, get that accomplishment. Because if you don't feel that sense of accomplishment partway through, it's kind of easy to give up. It's not quite the same on the older systems because the size of the collections are much smaller, but that's one way that I would approach it.
Can you guys hear in the back?
Yeah. Not especially that. So I am more into collecting for Super Nintendo, mainly because a few years ago I had about 60 that I started out with from when I was a kid. And they were in pretty good condition, so I said, hey, I should try to complete this. Let me go check and see how many Super Nintendo games there are. 720 what? Yeah. So a little bit further down that line, but it's not something you're going to do really quick unless you spend a lot of money up front on eBay. So I think something else is, in general, take your time when it comes to tackling any sort of subdivision of collecting or anything like that.
Yeah, a lot of people get into video game collecting and get burned out on it because they just go after everything at once. So what Sid says is good about just breaking it up. There's a lot of NES collectors I've seen that. They go out, they buy the most expensive rare NES games, and then a year later, they're putting it back on eBay and selling it. So make sure when you're collecting in general, collect what you want, not just because it's all out there to get. This isn't 1998 anymore when you can get most of the games really cheap. This is a different generation of game collecting right now. So yeah, collect what you like, collect what you want, and don't go nuts. Kind of ease into it.
I basically collect for everything. Yeah, I just want all of everything. Right. I agree with Sid though, with breaking it up into smaller sections. Like right now, I want all the Nintendo 64 wrestling games bought. So that's what I'm going for right now. Picked up 3 on this trip actually. There's a little spoiler for you.
I kind of go for everything anyway because I'm ADD. And so when I try to focus on one thing, I'm like, oh, but that's cool. Let me get that. So it never really works out for me.
There's a tip on here, right? A little tips here. that lists are your friend, but be careful, because there's a lot of sites like Wikipedia may not have a complete list of games that may be false. You may not know it, but like a lot of the NES lists, they'll list some PAL games or Australian games on there, not just the US games. You've got to be careful what you go for. There are apps out there. There are good websites. Nintendo Age has an excellent resource for searching for Nintendo games and listing them by year. But even something like that, like their developer list is totally wrong on the site. I should tell them that. It's totally wrong. They're totally off. But the
publisher...
Oh, you can? Okay. But the publisher is correct, for example, so that's fine. So yeah, there's lots of resources when you're going out there, so at least you know where to start.
So another one that I personally have used for my Super Nintendo collection, I'll probably keep going back to that, is Digital Press, because they have a master list of games for pretty much any system, what they consider to be, you know, official release games, so you're not going to find Super Nova's Arc 3D on there or anything. But, I mean, would you say that they're a pretty good resource, Pat, Sid?
I haven't used that much.
Okay, I just take the entire list and I export it into a like an Excel sheet or a Google Doc, and then I have that, you know, on my phone whenever I need to check what I have.
I would agree with that. There's also, as a collector myself, I've been very frustrated with lists because Wikipedia is particularly notorious for this, right? As you mentioned, there's games on there that are making PAL formats, and I'll talk about importing later on. But one of the problems I've always found is that a lot of these lists have games that have been canceled. I have found online retailers that have listings for games, box art, everything, that would lead you to believe that that particular game exists. It's going to drive you crazy to try and find that. So I have actually created some of my own lists. I have friends that work for a lot of the game publishers and companies, and even they, like for example, Sony, you'd think that they would have a list of every game they've ever published, right? Or made for the system. No, they don't. They do, but it has stuff on it because they grant licenses to a lot of developers who, for whatever reason, don't finish the game. They don't have money, the game gets canceled by the publisher, whatever. So the lists that are out there, just be really careful. That's one of my points. Like the stuff that's on my own site, for example, is stuff that I've verified, and I've used these lists to complete my own collections. I have a number of complete collections now, and I know that the lists are right because I physically have all the items, and I've done all kinds of verification to make sure I'm not missing anything. So, just a tip, just make sure when you're trying to get everything on your list that you're using a good list to start with, otherwise you will go insane.
Speaking of lists, how do you track your collection? Like I said, there are apps you can do. I prefer this method, it's cheaper, and you can do more with it. You just create an Excel database, list your games in there. It might take a while to do it the first time, but you do that, you're set. Put it on Google Docs. Now, you can get an app on your phone for Google Docs to access it, and then you can even edit it on your computer. It exists on Google's cloud, so you edit it on there from anywhere, and it'll update, and then your phone will be updated when you access the app, too. And so you can not just track the games you have, you make a list of like what I want to look for, what manuals I want to look for, different tabs in Excel files, or different files themselves. And that's the way I track my collection at this point.
Yeah, and that's something, like I said, if you have a smartphone, that's something that's always on you if you're anywhere near a data connection. Right here, this is my Super Nintendo list, and I have box, instruction book, and actual game. And I just put a little X mark by that, and I have, you can write some little macros and stuff. It's really not hard. Go to the Excel help section, it'll tell you how to do it. And then when I put a little X there, it makes a green box. When I have all three, it checks a little extra box that says complete, and it's easy. And I keep track in it, like a running total of games, so I can kind of track my progress every once in a while. Like, oh, I only have 500 more games to go.
Yeah. We use what's called NES Collector, N64 Collector, SNES Collector, etc., etc. Fortunately, it's only for iPhone. I guess if you have any iDevice or what do they call it, iOS. I'm very computer literate, y'all, so I apologize, but it's a lot like what Joey was just saying. You can get like a wanted list, you make a wanted list, and it'll show you box art covers, and you can check cartridge, manual, box, all that kind of stuff, and it'll tell you how many you need left. And
it's almost required unless you're okay with inevitably finding doubles and triples of things, because you're like, do I have this? I don't know, I'll get it anyway, and you get hung on. It's either that or sheets and sheets of paper, which I think Pat's also doing.
I started with sheets and sheets of paper. I came across this app, and I think the NES one was, what, $4 or $5?
Four.
And in my opinion, the best $4 I've ever spent. I started buying stuff I already had, especially for other systems like Master System, I get home and be like, oh, it's already on my shelf. So.
You know, Carrie went to swap me literally like 12, you know, staples, and I'm just checking off the games I'm looking for. And that list wasn't even totally correct, you know, and that's how we used to do it back in the day. God, I'm old. All right.
I used to use paper. Started with paper, went to spreadsheets, same thing. And then today I use an app called Collectors with Z or Z, depending on where you're from. And it's available at collectors.com, and they do have an iPhone and Android app as well. Desktop app that's available for PC and Mac. And one of the things I like about that app, because I've been in the same boat as these guys, like I have bought so many things that I already had, so I always have to have my collection with me. They do have a mobile app. They do have a cloud version of your collection that you can upload so I can access it from anywhere. I can share it with anybody without worrying about getting access to any of my other stuff. And I find it works really, really well for me. Some people complain because, you know, they do want, we're always charging for updates and stuff like that, but you don't have to update, and it does support every single platform, so you can actually, like, one app and you will have, like, every, like, for someone like me who collects more everything, it's a better app for me, a better choice, because it covers anything, even future apps, there's no restriction on, you can add your own platform, so when something new comes out, you can just add it, so that's the one that I use, but if you're specializing on just one list or something like that, then maybe one of these other apps would be a better choice.
Next topic, we spoke about this at SGC, you guys were there. Like, how do you deal with stickers and used games that are marked up? So, there's a few tips, I don't know if you can put it on the list, but you know what, get it on the list,
yeah. especially if you go to kind of sketchy places to get used games. if you go to like swap meets or flea markets, that you know, usually you get games that are pretty dirty. I've found that for permanent marker, a Magic Eraser, Mr. Clean Magic Eraser, with like a little bit of, you know, all-purpose cleaner, gets permanent marker out really well. For stickers, I use Goo Gone. Works pretty well. Just spray it, let it sit for 10 minutes, and then just scrub it off.
So I think Mr. Clean Magic Eraser is available in Canada. The trade name for that, I believe, is melamine foam. Basically what it is, it used to be used in insulation. It's a very, very, very fine structure that will sand, it does sand away the top layer of whatever surface you're rubbing it on. So you have to be a little bit careful. But it's really, there's nothing better for getting Sharpie off of plastic. I wouldn't use it on cardboard, but
you need to be careful with the Goo Gone on the label.
Aerospray or permanent marker.
Yeah. I've heard of that. That's good.
You need to be careful with the Goo Gone on the label. For the most part, you'll be fine with it. Just don't let soak on there for too long. I had a Battletoads Double Dragon that looked like crap. They had a sticker on top of the label. And I was able to get that off looking pretty good, but you just want to be careful and not get the Goo Gone on the edge of the label, because what will happen, it'll start peeling up a little bit. So just keep that in mind.
That's a petroleum-based product that will basically dissolve any sort of adhesive, so you guys should
have that. All right, it's a chemistry class now, too. the other thing, the best thing, which you can use it on labels as well, but also for systems. So many systems come across have packing tape on it or stickers. You get a hair dryer, you just put that baby on it, and let it heat up, and slowly peel it off after the glue's warm, and you're good. You know, it'll usually come off. Just be careful, you can still take away some of the box, but it'll come off. It just takes a while.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing. And also, it doesn't really apply to systems that have cardboard-based packaging or whatever, but anything that's in more modern, you know, DVD case or whatever, don't forget, when you're out shopping and you find your deals or whatever, we've all come across the 99-cent sports game. And sometimes they're brand new for that price, and you may, you know, turn your nose up at that stuff, but you know what? What a great deal. Buy those things and use the packaging and replace the guts and the the sleeve from one that's, if you've got one that's particularly dirty or it's got a lot of stickers and it's just going to be a pain to do that, why not swap it? It's not, I do that all the time.
Especially for the PlayStation 1 dual disc or multi discs. I recently got, Dragon Warrior 7, which is, you know, it's an uncommon game. But it was cracked. I was able to get it for a good price on eBay because of it was scuffed and cracked on the actual case. And I just had a crappier game, for example. I just swapped it out. You have to be a little bit careful, but swap out the paper inserts. It just pulls up. It's a jewel case.
You actually can buy repros of those cool disc sets. You can buy them online. They're like the exact same ones they used 15 years ago.
Ooh, and something else, actually, I found this probably for a lot of different things, but for Super Nintendo games in particular, it's hard to find the trays that games come in. You'll find a lot of boxes, like Super Nintendo or NES boxes.
Or Game Boy games.
People throw out those inserts, and so it'll just be the game inside. If you go on eBay, you can get dozens of them for not much, like $5, and they're reproduction trays. Or even the styrofoam bits for NES games or Game Boy trays, and so they are out there. You wouldn't think necessarily to look for them. It looks just as good as the old trays.
Where would you go to find that?
eBay. That's where I go.
Another tip, if the back of your game, especially like NES cards or 64, if the back of the case is messed up or chipped, you can actually take a bit screw and replace it with the back of another game. They're identical, so. Yeah.
They're mostly identical. They're special ones. Just search on eBay for like N64. The same one is used for like N64 Super Nintendo. The NES is a different one. It's much slightly smaller. They're like $5-$6 shipped. So you need to be careful with them. The only thing is on the NES game, the NES did have like 3 or 4 different stickers. Like the later games had a battery, like a gold sticker on the back. And the later NES games had a smaller writing on the back for like the Flintstones dinosaur game card. But the original, but whatever. If you want to swap out your card back, who cares? No one's going to quarter care.
Let me see if I get a couple of better angles.
Yeah,
sure. Go ahead, Bill.
What else we got here?
When to collect.
Sure.
Start?
You want to start about when to collect versus?
You collect when it's cheap.
And when is that?
Let's see. Well, if you're like me, it's all the time. I'm cheap, basically. That's what it boils down to. So, towards the end of a system's lifespan, what would be the word there? Life cycle. Okay. Towards the end, like Wii games right now are extremely cheap. I'm trying to think what else. PSP games are getting pretty cheap right now, I think. So,
yeah,
I mean,
it's really the best time is when a system's going out because like modern stores you can go to right now, like GameStop. Or Best Buy, they'll just mark them down because they just want to get rid of them. They don't want them in the store anymore.
Also, pawn shops, like,
yeah,
a lot of people start trading their stuff off. Their current systems off. And pawn shops and stuff because they want to get the next thing that's just coming out. Like the Wii U, or the 3DS, or the Vita, or whatever. And so I've gone to tons of pawn shops and found, like, awesome, like, Wii games and DS games, and PS3 games, during the last time of PS3, which is dirt cheap. It's a perfect opportunity.
Be quiet, Billy.
Hi, everybody. My name is Elsie Mofor. I'm Jessica. I'm a director. So, we're not over capacity, but how we talk about the HCC, there's fire marshal warnings. So, we're going to go argue with them. But I'm going to ask everybody who's over there to, in that corner, just make sure you're clearing the door. And I don't think it's fair to kick anybody out, especially considering we're not really at capacity, but if you do leave, what we're going to do is we have buttons, and if you want to leave now, get a free button. A fair trade. So if you volunteer to leave,
us or button. Us or button.
Pretty much. So
get a button? Leave?
Yeah, nobody's going to be kicked though, but just make sure the doorway is clear. That's it.
She's not saying anyone has to leave.
Yeah.
Just make sure the exit is clear.
But I'm offering what?
Toy stores, electronic stores, they buy a bunch of thinking, oh boy, it's the next hot thing. People are going to buy it. And when no one does, they're stuck with a ton of unused product, and they fire sale that as well. I remember Dreamcast, when it was officially cut off, you could buy those, you know, you could buy a whole pack. So you, new Dreamcast, new games, put a whole collection together for $50. So.
Something else you can do is GameStop. Once they start or stop carrying, you know, the last system games, they want to get rid of it. It's taking up shelf space, so they'll start clearancing all that stuff out. So PlayStation 2, I think they just stopped. So, just stopped taking PS2 games. So go away, GameStop.
Another tip that sort of goes along with all of that is that a lot of times the most valuable games, and this is like particularly true of say the original PlayStation, are the ones that come out right at the end of the system cycle. So you might not want to pay full price for some of those, but keep in mind that if you buy them when the system is on the way out, that those are the ones that likely will go up in value and also will be really, really hard to find because as the system is going out, nobody's buying the game. So the ones that are released right at the end are usually produced in much lower quantities. So those are going to be tougher to find. So just keep that in mind. If you're looking at something as the last, you know, for example, the last PlayStation 2 games, which are mostly sports titles, could actually be worth something. And actually having a sports title other than that basketball game on the GameCube actually be worth something is kind of a shock.
If we're also talking about timing when you start purchasing for your collections, it's not on here, but I think it's going to be time to bring it up now. When you have a game system or game systems that people grew up with and they were popular, when those people reach mature age where they get jobs and, you know, expendable cash, expect those retro games to spike in value. I think Pat has mentioned this a few times, like 6-7 years ago, NES games went from, you could find them almost anywhere for pretty darn cheap, and then all of a sudden, boom, they're, you know, kind of nuts. And you'll see, I've seen that in the past year or two with Super Nintendo and Genesis games, more Super Nintendo, because kids who grew up with the 16-bit era, when they were 5 to 10 years old, now they have jobs, and they're like, oh, God, I want to buy Earthbound. Blah, 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 I'm going to spend $300 on this game.
So it's like 3 to 4, about 3 game generations back is when stuff starts getting collectible.
So it's like the cycle where, you know, things are new, and then they become old and crappy and no one wants them, and then become retro, and in those hands, so more valuable again.
So right now, like, the N64, PlayStation 1 era, that's like the next collectible area. That's like 3 gaming generations back.
I think, Jay, you said someone was saying that they had the second rarest N64 game with them here, boxed. They're selling it for $60.
What is it?
I can't remember. Someone had it. I can't remember. But see, exactly. No one cares so much about the 64 right now. But give it 3 years, and it'll be a lot more expensive.
Well, I mean, the farms are international.
No.
In my opinion, the rare 64 game is the Clay Fighter Skulker's Cup.
You were talking about that.
Right.
Yes.
What, do you want to get into that, or we
as an example,
cartridge,
you know,
and label
very
variants.
Rare game that
right.
is only available Blockbuster, and you can get it for like $60, you know?
No, it's a little more than that now.
62.
It's like 200, Rube.
Yeah, the cartridge alone, I guess depending on where you're at, goes $100 to $200, I'm being told now. Obviously, when you add the box and manual, the price just triples at that point. So, but like they were saying, 64, PlayStation, that's going to be the next one that's going to spike up. So,
buy now.
Buy now. No, don't buy now, because it's about to. Just wait. I'm buying now.
Watch episode 30 of the Game Chasers when Jay tries to buy my copy.
$2.
Really?
$2.
$2.
$2.
I actually got it completed at $64.
So what about the variants, like label variants, greatest hits? Do you guys collect them? Why or why not?
I'm a big fan of, I guess it depends on the system. Like, can we all agree the PlayStation greatest hits is the ugliest thing ever?
Yes.
Even the game. From the original PlayStation. Those I don't really like, but like the Wii player's choice, I don't mind those. I don't mind grabbing those. Yeah, I don't mind that either.
It's the same game. If you want it purely to play the game, it doesn't really matter.
So this one's Game of the Year edition. This one's the original edition.
Yeah, and that's
this one's the greatest hits edition. I mean, for me personally, I am a greatest hits player's choice, whatever snob. I do not want those versions. I always buy the first releases. And the only time I ever collect any of those types of versions, like in this case, is either I'm completely in love with the franchise and whatever single variant and Centurion. I think it looks cool, hence the Blades of Steel. And also, something, you have to be careful because some player's choice editions have slight variances. So for example, on PlayStation 2, the Crash Bandicoot Wrath of Cortex, the first release had terrible long load times. There's some kid somewhere still waiting for the next level to load. He's got the original release and he's still waiting. But they fixed that in the greatest hits version. So sometimes it's good to get the player's choice, but for me, I have no.
When it comes to like player's choice, I won't not buy it, but with certain games like Final Fantasy VII, if I run across like the green label first, I'll pick it up obviously, but I'll always be on the lookout for the black label.
Yeah, okay, sure.
Right, and if you're into like variants, just with that game specifically, there's a misprint on one of them, which is worth way more than the black label or the green label. As far as like 5-screw, 3-screw, and seals, the circle and the oval seal of quality on the NES games, I don't obsess like that, because if I do, then I'll just go crazy.
So the problem is that there are so many different kinds of variants. Like you were saying, NES games can be 3-screw or 5-screw. You can have different companies making the same game. I didn't even realize, because I had a digital press list, that Empire Strikes Back was made by two different companies, depending on when you got it, you know?
Right.
Like one was JVC and the other was THQ. Thank you. Yeah, same game, just different publisher. I don't know why, but I wasn't looking to get both, but I happened to get both, and I was like, okay. So
yeah. Something I will get to of like the Blades of Steel. Norm, if you want to hold that up. A lot of people don't even know this, but the original Blades of Steel was what, silver? So I guess silver label. Well, in 92, Nintendo basically released what was essentially greatest hits. It was Blades of Steel, Zelda 1, Zelda 2, Metroid, which is completely different label altogether. There's
Punch
two,
out.
And no, what Punch Out? Shut up, Scott.
Punch Out came out in the classic.
Shut up, Scott!
Punch
Out
was
a classic. The re-release on Blades of Steel, it's a red label.
Yeah,
it's
funny because that's
I was the only one in the series. Yeah.
Right, and if you look at the actual cartridge, you can obviously tell it's noticeable. One, the label is completely red, the other one is silver. But don't mistake like more rare for more expensive. They're both. It's a $2 game if you see it in the anywhere. Honestly, it's Blades of Steel. There was 9 million copies made. So.
I think the takeaway from this is that everyone up here is OCD, but not that OCD.
When it comes to label variants. I just don't care. I really don't. It doesn't affect me.
It has to be a major sort of change. Like the Metroid re-release, that's totally different label. If it's a minor thing, I don't care. I don't care, like the THQ versus KBC.
It's
the
only difference. That,
yeah, same
it's
game.
It's the same label.
Yeah.
It's like, who cares?
I mean, it's the same kind of difference as a collector's edition, you know.
I don't have that one. Yeah. So. Question in the back about this topic?
I was saying some of them do have extras. There's a few like that for all platforms, and in those cases, I have those as well. But so There's not a lot that are like that, but there are definitely a few.
The Metal Gear release.
Yellow disc. Like, what?
Yeah.
I picked up in Portland. Oh, no, Classic Gaming Expo in Vegas from Chris Kohler of Wired.com.
The music's even better in it, too.
Sorry?
The music sounds a little bit better in it, too.
Yeah,
I'm
not sure. The funny thing is, I didn't know what to play it. I just thought it was cool. So, yeah, that's just me.
I've got a good example of when you should do an import. Everyone's familiar, well, maybe everyone's familiar with a game called Little Samson. Eric, poor Eric here. Eric, why don't you stand up?
Why don't you stand up, Eric?
poor Eric has been wanting Little Samson for a long time. He's been doing some terrible things to try to get a copy. Well, the guy, instead of buying Little Samson, he got a Famicom and imported Lickle, which is the Japanese version. It is, $80 compared to $700? There it is right there. Lickle, Legend of Hula Bell. This is a good example of a game you should get if you just want to play it, because, again, the game has no text at all. It's the exact same game, so you're saving a lot of money by importing Lickle.
Still not the same.
Yeah, now, if you're a serious collector and you have to have Little Samson, yeah, but you just want to play the game. Yeah, it's...
There's a lot of you competitive.
Don't, like, all of you guys have Samson, too?
I don't know if all of us. There we
go. No. Have the manual.
Oh, yeah. Make a deal for that. So basically, a lot of people on eBay now are starting to cash in on, like, Flintstones titles for Pete and Craze. Now they're trying to sell the Famicom one and raise the price up. Just be careful. Don't let them set the prices. And if you find out, I mean, there's Japanese auction sites too. You can kind of see what they actually are going for to get an idea. They're probably cheaper to buy them there and get them, you know, from here. There's intermediary websites that do that. They'll actually bid on auctions for you. Japanese websites. That's another topic.
My take on the import thing, similar to a lot of my fellow panelists, I'm not big on importing stuff just because I figure, man, I have a hard enough time getting the domestic stuff as it is. However, you know, every once in a while someone will present me with a great deal, but I can't pass them on. I have a lot of Dreamcast imports, for example, one of them being Shenmue 2. This is a really nice, I mean, you can get this now on Xbox, right? But at the time, you couldn't get this any other way. And it's kind of cool, just because it's got a little bit more to it, so that's a case where I would do that. The other time that me personally, I'll do it is if it's a franchise that I really, really like. So, for example, Legend of Zelda, I do have Ocarina of Time. I've got on the PAL version, I have Japanese version. And also, sometimes it's interesting, like if you look at, for example, Ratchet and Clank, which are favorite game series of mine on PlayStation 2, Japanese artwork is completely different for Ratchet. It looks very different. And so it's kind of neat to do that. So in that particular case, I've also brought in some of those. So for me, that's how I do it. I stay away from it generally, because the other thing is it can be really, really expensive.
I'm not too big on imports either, but there are a few games out there I've always been fascinated with. Turnip being one of them. Thank you for that, Rue.
You're welcome.
And but I ended up only just getting the repo card, for obvious reasons. But I'm not too big on importing.
Well, it's definitely harder when you pick up a text-heavy game.
Well, exactly.
If you don't know Japanese, games, yeah. So. But interestingly enough, because RPGs are so big in Japan, games that are, yes, popular over here, but a little bit more expensive, like to get a box Final Fantasy 3 or Chrono Trigger, it's going to set you back a little bit. They sell those things like candy in Japan. You can get those boxed for, like, shipped from Japan for $20, you know. It's kind of interesting. That's one of those games. If you really love Final Fantasy 6, you know, hey, why not spend another $20 and get a box version of the Japanese? That's kind of the art school, you know, it's something to put in.
I'm more of a, well, first of all, in Dallas Fort Worth, we don't run across a lot of imports at all. 3 hours south of us in Austin, they're everywhere. But imports are more expensive. I'm more like import Dreamcast fighting games. You know, that's, exactly, I get that. If I like the series, like Tekken, I'm a huge Tekken nut. I ran across 1, 2, and 3 imports not too long ago. Actually, I think it was, what, episode or two back. And I overpaid for them, but it's Tekken, so I was happy to do it.
For the most part, I only collect import games I actually want to play or are interested in, like, I think it was Takashi's Castle, the worst game ever. You know what I'm talking about. This comedian, Takashi, and he designed this game where it's frustratingly hard on purpose. And if you watch what is it, the CX Game Challenge show,
there's maybe one or five or 20 of them. There's not a lot of any given game. So there's some question about how much they actually are worth. I know, Pat, you've been looking at getting a prototype game of anything for a while now. So what kind of prices are you seeing lately in general?
I don't know. Here's the problem that, and this is going to be controversial, I don't care.
There are people that are trying to just corner the prototype market. There's maybe like five people at most that want to get every prototype for every system. That's not even far out of the truth. And so they're trying to set the price of these games. So an NES prototype 6-7 years ago, you can pick one up for like 50, 60 bucks. Now you can't get any NES prototype that cheap. You know, they're going to go for like $200. We're talking like games that aren't even popular. We're talking like just D-level games that you don't care about, that they're all going to cost a couple hundred dollars at least.
Mickey Mouse.
Yeah. Well, that, let alone a game like Ninja Gaiden or the prototype they're trying to sell for like $2,000 or whatever.
Yeah.
Or, you know, they're trying to sell the Tetris prototype for like $25,000, which I think is ridiculous. But again, there's no set prices. Whatever you want to pay for it. There's only a few of them. The rule of thumb is that if a game's popular, the prototype's worth more. If it's a first-party game, at least for NES, it's worth a lot more. If it was never released, it's worth a hell of a lot more, because then what people do is they'll buy it, dump it, and then make money off the reproduction cards, which is highly illegal. But I'm not saying it's bad, because how else are you going to get a game like the one that Joey owns, which is... Let's go.
Mother 1 for the translated Mother 1 for NES, Earthbound. Yes. So yeah, I think there's still only four of those that exist. But and I was talking to is that something? We're talking about that later about homebrew reproduction. Oh, do you want to talk about the reproduction with the homebrew or?
Sure.
Okay, I'll hold off on that because I do have some thoughts on reproduction cards. But yeah, because someone 15 years ago found a translated prototype already finished of Earthbound for the NES, they were able to dump it, and then that ROM was taken and has been sold many, many, many times over as reproduction cards. So it's becoming a kind of a big business to do that.
And that's the reason why the price is going up, because now people see it as dollar signs. They see an unreleased game. We were at an auction, I think it was in Vegas or Portland, they did the auction. And there was a bidding war between an actual video game collector named Steve Lin, who's just a big video game collector, great guy, collects everything. He actually buys his prototypes and dumps them for free to everyone, to the public, versus a guy who was trying to get it just to buy it, just to make money off it and dump it out of business.
Yeah.
And I knew that was going on. I knew the two parties. And it's just, that's the different philosophy. Some people see it as a business. A lot of people see it as a business, or I can try to put my Tetris prototype, or the Legend of Zelda prototype, which wasn't a prototype. It was like it was a translation the first time they tried to translate it. They tried to pawn it off as a prototype, but it wasn't, technically, and tried to sell it for like $20,000. And so they're trying to make a business out of it. I don't agree with it. I just don't agree with it. But people are doing it. They're trying to make a lot of money.
So, yeah, if you're looking for your own prototype, especially for NES or Super Nintendo, you're going to have a baseline of $100-ish. Add more money if it's... Like Pat said, if it's unreleased, definitely add a lot of money. If it's got a following, like Ninja Gaiden or Earthbound or whatever, add money. Things like that, and they're going, getting kind of crazy. There was an Earthbound prototype that, like an actual Earthbound for the Super Nintendo prototype, I think it just went for $3,500 or so on eBay.
Yeah.
And that was probably, the guy had two of them. I think that's the one that sold for less. So.
Two?
Yeah, two.
Some of you that follow what we do at the Computer Museum may know that we found a game for the 2600, the only known Canadian-developed Atari 2600 game from the day. And there was both a prototype and a released version, and there's only one prototype. But just to give you an example, we'll never sell it, because from a historical perspective, we're going to keep it. We did release a repro card, which we sold very reasonably at $45 and limited it to 100. We then released the ROM for free, and I think that in a lot of cases, and we actually used the money that we did make, which honestly wasn't that much considering all the labor we had to go through, went towards the museum and helping out pay hydro bills and stuff like that. But I was actually offered $10,000 for that card. But again, that's from one person, and it could be worth that to one person, but is that the true value of it? Well, I guess like anything, it's whatever someone will offer you for something is what it's worth, but prototypes are just impossible to price down. You have your head up for a lot of these models.
This was for Norm. The monster party, the Famicom version, has that been dumped / sold again? Famicom version of monster party.
Famicom version?
Yeah. One that wasn't released, the prototype.
I don't think the prototype's available to play. There's no ROM for it. Somebody bought it and they just won't give it up, so they won't dump it or anything. You can look at YouTube.